today, I'm Novaline Brewster, Chief of Corporate Communications at the Central Bank of Barbados. And with me is Dr. Linda Tesar, a professor of economics at the University of Michigan and the bank's sixth distinguished visiting fellow and our first female scholar. Dr. Tesar is a prolific researcher in international finance with a particular interest in the international transmission of business cycles and fiscal policy, the benefits of global risk sharing, capital flows to emerging markets, international tax competition, and the impact of exchange rate exposure. She will be the bank's and the country's guest for the next 2 weeks. Dr. Tesar joins an impressive list of fellows that we have hosted since 2014. The fellows help our staff and you, our viewers, to understand global economic developments and how they may impact us. They provide a platform for debate and discussion on emerging economic issues. And as the world's top economic thinkers, we are delighted to engage with them and exchange our ideas and perspectives. On their part, they are happy to absorb all that this beautiful island has to offer. Welcome to Barbados, Dr. Tesar.
Thank you so much. I'm delighted to be here.
And of course, the bank and the country are delighted to host you. I mentioned your research areas in my introduction. Just explain for the non-economics minded people what your research is all about.
Sure. There were a lot of big words in that introduction, so let me pull that apart a little bit. I mean, basically, I've always been interested in the way economies are connected. What are the linkages that tie economies together, and how is it that when things happen somewhere else in the world, they affect us here at home? And that can happen through trade, through international capital flows, through exchange rates. These are all things I've been interested in, and that's what my research has focused on.
Yes, you've done a lot of work related to advanced economies.
Right.
Why should we in a small Caribbean island be interested in what you do?
That's a totally fair question. I've done some work on developing and emerging markets, so not all of my work has been on advanced economies. But really, the answer would be that I think that one of the great powers of economics is that the lessons that you learn essentially apply everywhere. You know, there are trade-offs between the different kinds of policies or the different kinds of choices one can make, and those things are basic principles that are true everywhere. Of course, there are differences. Of course, how things trade off and the magnitudes of different trade-offs are different depending upon the context, but really the underlying principles are the same. So I think there's a lot to learn from studying advanced economies and from studying emerging markets.
Over the lifetime of this fellowship program, we have learned a lot from the economists. I personally have. I want to zero in though on the issue of debt, because it is again emerging as a huge international issue.
Absolutely.
And it is the topic for our next economic forum on the 23rd of May, next door in the Grand Salle. Why is debt a problem now?
So debt worldwide has reached unprecedented proportions. So we now see debt to GDP at its highest rate ever. I would say that makes it an important issue to study, but I wouldn't say that necessarily makes it a crisis. But it certainly indicates that whenever you see something become bigger than it ever was before, that's something you should pay attention to and ask, how did that happen, and how worried should we be about it, and what are the strategies for dealing with it? So I think that's why we should be thinking about this issue of the rise in debt worldwide.
And how worried should we be about it?
So I think it's an issue, but I don't think it's a crisis. Basically, debt is an IOU that's exchanged between two parties. Might be banks, might be people, might be corporations, might be governments. And so for every person or entity that's borrowed, there's someone on the other side that's made a loan. And the issue is that we have a lot more of those loans in the global economy than we have before. Now, we know from the global financial crisis that having a lot of debt in that instance turned out to have some ramifications that we didn't fully understand. I think we learned a lot from the global financial crisis, so that makes me optimistic that I think we have policies and mechanisms in place to deal with debt. On the other hand, we also know that having a lot of debt means that there's a lot of people that are owed money, and we want to make sure that those transactions ultimately, that those that made the loans are ultimately paid back.
You're saying it's an issue, not a crisis. Any problem probability that it could mushroom into a crisis?
I think it could. I think the way to think about
it. And what would trigger that?
Well, I think the way to think about it is that the higher debt is, it gives you fewer degrees of freedom, because rising levels of debt mean that there's going to have to be, that debt is going to have to be paid back. So that means were new opportunities to come up, were some natural disaster, were some event to occur where one might like to borrow some more, that's going to be less possible. It also puts real constraints to the extent governments borrow, as in the case of Barbados, it puts constraints on what governments can do. So the only way out of debt really is either to grow, and that's difficult. We all wish we knew what the magic policy was to create more economic growth. It's to raise more tax revenues, which is also painful because you've got to impose taxes on different parts of the economy, or it's to tighten one's belts and cut back on expenditures. And the higher the debt level gets, the more those things become, the more you have to do of each of those things and the more painful it can be. So it's better to get ahead of it before it actually is a crisis, which is why I think it's worth talking about while it's still an issue and not a crisis.
Interesting point about debt, because as you know, we in Barbados, we've implemented measures to try to reduce our debt. Any thoughts on our program thus far?
From what I've read, it really does seem that Barbados is taking the right steps and, of course, working with the IMF to make sure that these programs, that the international community is also in agreement that these are the right steps. But I think broadening the tax base and making sure that the tax is somewhat progressive so that those at the top perhaps are paying a little more than those at the bottom. Really taking a hard look at expenditures and deciding where cuts can be made that aren't going to be too painful and, again, not fall too heavily on people that have a difficult time managing with those government spending cuts. I think all of those things seem to be discussed in a really careful and thoughtful way, and it seems that the plans are in place. There's a lot of reforms taking place in Barbados. It must be a very exciting time.
Most definitely is. And what I'm sensing you to say is that we are on the right track.
I would say so.
Prior to going on air, you said to me that you wanted to see more women in economics. What are you doing about that to encourage more women in economics?
Given how good the economics profession has been to me, I've done a lot of things. Actually, I'm continuing to try to work on figuring out why it is that women are deciding that economics isn't for them, and trying to make adjustments in the way we teach economics, the way we organize our classes, the way we describe what we do, and frankly, broadening the set of issues that economics focuses on to make sure that people know that it's really about human behavior and really trying to understand incentives. And there's so many ways that economics can lead to not only a rewarding career, but really, I think, be beneficial for society as a whole. So we're doing a bunch of projects at Michigan and elsewhere to try to study how women make choices and to really encourage them to both start taking economics, but to keep taking economics classes and hopefully go on to pursue.
And what are you seeing so far? Sorry.
I think it's having effects, but it's at the early stages, frankly. And you ask, does it matter? Why does it matter? And I think it matters because I think we need to have more diversity of views. I think every discipline should have people of different backgrounds, different genders, different races coming in and projecting and providing their experience and their backgrounds to speak to these issues. And I think the whole profession will be stronger if we do that.
Well, let's just pause for a few seconds with Dr. Tesar. We'll be right back.
Did you know the world's debt is US $184 trillion?
That works out to be US $86,000 for everyone in the world.
And this debt is higher today than before the global crisis in 2008.
Could this be the start of the next financial crisis? And are you ready to have this conversation?
On May 23rd, in the heart of Bridgetown,
one woman
will take us there.
Hello, everyone. I'm Dr. Linda Tesar, amateur surfer and the Central Bank of Barbados 2019 Distinguished Visiting Fellow. I invite you to join with me, host Julian Rogers, and a live audience for the 6th Caribbean Economic Forum, where we'll focus on how, in a world of rising debt, Caribbean countries can stay afloat.
Tune in to CBC TVA, Digicel, Trend Media, VOB 92.9, and CMC stations on May 23rd, 2019 at 8 p.m. for this educational discussion with special guest, Professor of Economics at the University of Michigan, Dr. Linda Tesar. Join us in our live Facebook discussion with moderators Anki Scott-Joseph, Crystal Howell, and Simon Natrum. Together, let us understand how to stay afloat in a world of rising debt.
Dr. Tesar, the IMF at its recent spring meetings described the world economy as being in a very delicate place. Help us understand what that means and what are the ramifications for Barbados and the rest of the Caribbean.
Sure. Well, I think one thing that makes the situation somewhat fragile or vulnerable is the fact that economic growth isn't as robust as one might have thought it would be. You know, 10 years after the global financial crisis, we're still kind of muddling along a bit, and a more robust rate of economic growth would certainly put the whole global economy on better footing. So that's one issue. I think another issue is the rise in global tensions. There just seems to be a lot of fragmentation, kind of rough edges out there regarding trade agreements, regarding global agreements over capital markets, over political tensions. So I think that's another area that leads to a vulnerability. And all of those things are concerning, especially given that we have some big problems potentially looming on the horizon. Issues like dealing with climate change are going to require us all to work together and not to be pulling apart. And so I think that makes one nervous a bit about the future.
So what does all this mean for us here in the Caribbean?
I think, for the Caribbean as well as the rest of the world, but maybe especially countries like Barbados, where the economy is very open to international trade, global things that happen in the world spill over into Barbados very easily. So I think what it means is that one has to develop strategies for being resilient and for being prepared, because there are going to be external shocks, things that change both in the environment and the world economy, and Barbados needs to be on sound footing to be prepared for those kinds of shocks.
So from where you sit, how should we be preparing?
Well, I think one of the things definitely is to get debt levels down, because that's just going to give the economy more breathing room and give the government and policymakers more room to adjust and accommodate to those shocks. I think also being a business-friendly climate where you don't have investors nervous about the state of affairs in Barbados and possibly thinking about looking for another place to locate. You really want Barbados to be the place where they feel secure, and this is the place to really invest. And of course, that's true for people who live in Barbados. They want to have confidence in the future so that they undertake the kinds of investments in their own education and in their futures in a way that helps the whole society and economy grow.
I want to take you back to the issue of global growth. What is timing impeding global growth? You said we're not experiencing robust.
I wish I knew. I think some of it is policy. I think some of it is perhaps too much austerity early on in the recovery, perhaps a misunderstanding that the recovery from the crisis was going to take longer, and so therefore it was going to take a more concerted effort to kind of help economies recover. I think early on there was a sense that, oh, this is a typical recession, and if we just wait it out, things are going to bounce back. Well, they haven't bounced back, and so the question is, what can we do in this more long run, seems like more permanent malaise? It's going to take like longer term thinking and a longer term commitment to sort of helping the economy recover.
You mentioned the global economic tensions. Were you referring perhaps to the trade war between China and your country? Again, what does that mean for us should that trade war really get out of hand?
Well, I don't think it's good news for anyone. I don't think it's good news for the United States. I don't think it's good news for China. It was one of the things that was on my mind as someone who's always been a believer in the benefits of international trade and the benefits of allowing countries to specialize in the things that they do best and being able to sell those things to the world economy and bring in from the rest of the world what it has to offer. That's where the gains come from. So seeing us retrench from that and retreat from the global marketplace, I think is not good across the board. It's also the case that greater engagement in international markets is also good for global peace. Evidence shows the more we're connected with each other, the more we depend on each other, the less likely we are to adopt policies that are bad for for other countries. And so I think this is also a negative outcome potentially from having these escalating trade wars.
I want to come back home to Barbados, and yes, one of the issues we're still trying to grapple with is the whole international debt restructuring. Any thoughts as to how we should proceed to bring closure to that matter?
So I think the best that Barbados can do is, it's going to involve negotiations, and the best thing to do is to negotiate from a position of strength. So I think having the domestic house in order, having the credibility to say we're undertaking the difficult steps that we need to take to make Barbados a stronger economy. And of course, international creditors want to be paid back. So they're going to want Barbados to be in the strongest position possible, because that is going to increase the likelihood that Barbados will make good on paying its debt. So I think there's room for a win-win there by making the Barbados economy as strong as it can be.
You've been here for a couple of days. What are your impressions of Barbados, and what are you looking forward to most?
What a beautiful country. People have been so friendly. We've just had, in the short time we've been here, we've had a marvelous time. I guess I would say what I look forward to most is just really talking to people, learning more about the culture, learning more about Barbados history, enjoying the food, and certainly we'll do a little bit of fun on the beach as well.
Well, it has been a pleasure chatting with you. Thank you very much, Dr. Tesar. And of course,
here,
we look forward to hosting you here at the bank, and you'll get that opportunity to speak with various Barbadians over the next 2 weeks. So that has been my interview with Dr. Linda Tesar. It was a pleasure chatting with her, and we invite you to tune in to the Caribbean Economic Forum on May 23rd. The topic then will be, in a world of rising debt, how can Caribbean countries stay afloat? Interesting discussion indeed. Thank you for tuning in, and remember to share, like, and comment. See you next time.